Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask for your blessing on our efforts to glorify your name in everything that we do and everything that we say. We ask it in his holy name. Amen.
Hi there, this is James Kapasa, and welcome to the Bible Education Center. Today I'll be sharing my views and my thoughts on this particular subject right over here, Christianity and African religion. Thank you for tuning in. God bless. Christianity and African religion. This is quite a broad topic, and simply because it's a topic whereby a lot of African people struggle with this topic. They struggle to make sense of this topic. They struggle to find out if Christianity and African religion, whether the two are one or if they are two separate entities. Now, a lot of questions come from this particular topic. Some of the questions are, is there a difference between being an African and being a Christian? Can the two coexist? Can one be both a Christian and an African? And some of you might be thinking, what if I'm not African? Does this study still apply to me? Well, later on, I'll show just how this study applies to everyone, regardless of whether you are African or not. So let's start off with first trying to define what makes an African man or woman. What makes you an African man or woman? Now, if you grew up in an African environment, in an African culture, there are certain things that were passed on to you from your fathers, things that were passed on from generation to generation, all the way back from your forefathers. Now, these things define you, they make you an African. These are things usually to do with like dance, music, how we worship or who we worship, how we behave at work, and how we meditate. All of these things summarize and make up our traditions, our culture, and all of these things have been passed on from generation to generation. Then one day on your walk in life, you encounter or you come across this Christianity thing, you come across this Christianity faith and movement, and you get to hear about this Jesus guy and how he was the Son of God and how God is the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, who pretty much represent the Jewish community, the Jewish nation. But this God is also more than just that. He's the God of the whole wide world. And this God has a plan and a purpose for this whole wide world. He has a plan and purpose for everyone living in this whole wide world. That's right. He also has a plan for me. Exactly. Me, an African man. This God has a plan for me. And this plan that God has for me, it's much deeper than just a plan and a purpose. He actually wants me to be a part of his family, his global family. Now, as an African, this is good news to me. This is exciting news to me, because if there's one thing that we as Africans are used to, it's exclusion. Being excluded from partaking in things simply because of the color of your skin. We've been excluded from job opportunities. We've been excluded from education. We've been excluded from even dating or making friends simply because of the color of our skin. And so, of course, when we hear about this God who's all-inclusive and he wants you regardless of the color of your skin, this sounds like music to us. This sounds like good news to us. And so what we do is we take that step forward into this Christianity thing. We take this step forward into finding out more about who this God is. But then suddenly, you get people who stop you right over there. And they basically tell you that, hey, you can't just be a part of this Christianity thing. if you want to be a part of this Christianity thing, then you have to let go of all your cultures and all your traditions and all your beliefs as an African. And this becomes problematic for us, for me, as an African person, simply because it makes me start asking questions such as, am I not good enough for God? Is God not wanting someone who's African? I mean, can I not be both an African and a Christian? I mean, what more can I do to be a Christian? What does the Bible say about Africans and about Christians? And that's exactly where we're going to go to right now. We're going to go into the book of Acts, and we're going to look at the story, this incredible story about Philip and the Ethiopian, and how this Ethiopian man became the very first African to be a Christian. And we're going to look at his story and the lessons that we can learn from this Ethiopian man. Now, the story sets off in Acts. Now, just to give you a context of the story, what was happening was the early church was growing in the early parts of Acts. And what happened was that one day there was complaining in the church. Ooh, this is 2,000 years ago. I'm glad that we don't complain again as a church. I'm glad that we don't find people complaining in any church, right? So there was complaining in the church, and the complaints came from the distribution of food. What happened was the Gentile widows were complaining that when it came to the distribution of food, the Jewish widows were actually receiving more than they were. And so this created this tension, this created this conflict in the church. And so there was this whole, you know, discriminating thing happening, this whole prejudice thing happening. And so the disciples had to make a decision. They had to make a decision going forward, how they were going to deal with such matters. So what they did was they chose 7 men who were going to become leaders, if I may put it that way, to handle and solve such disputes. And so they became like the deacons at church. And while one of these leaders was Stephen, who we will see later on, and Philip was one of these leaders. And so now Philip and this Ethiopian, the story is in Acts 8. I'll read from verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandake, which means Queen of Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, go to the chariot and stay near it. So now we get introduced to the second character in the story, this Ethiopian treasurer, this Ethiopian man. And the writer of Acts, who's Luke, adds a certain detail about this man that I believe he wants us to know. Luke wants us to know the certain detail about this man. This was more than just an afterthought. It wasn't an afterthought. Luke tells us that this man was a eunuch. He refers to him as the Ethiopian eunuch. And at first when I read this, I remember thinking to myself, man, that's just a bit too much info. I mean, we could have been fine just knowing that he's an Ethiopian man. Like, why not refer to him as the Ethiopian man or the Ethiopian treasurer? Why go as far as telling us that this man was a eunuch? And I think that there's a reason for that, which we will be going to look at now. But first, if you don't know what a eunuch is, a eunuch is simply a man that has had a painful surgical procedure to remove some of his male genitals. So that is a eunuch. And the other thing we learn about this Ethiopian eunuch is that he is in the search for God. He's trying to find God. He's traveled all the way from Africa, Ethiopia, all the way up to Jerusalem to find God, to worship this God he's heard so much about. And so what I want to do now is look at the story from the perspectives of Philip and this Ethiopian man. We'll first start off with Philip. Philip's story starts off in Acts 1. These words which you're reading in front of you now are the last words of Jesus before he went up to heaven. This is the old King James Version, but simply what Jesus is saying to his disciples is that he will give them power, and he will do that simply because he wants them to be his witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and ultimately to the ends of the earth. That's what Jesus wants of them. And so Jesus goes up to heaven and he leaves them like that. But he tells them, do not leave Jerusalem as yet until the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And in the next chapter, the Holy Spirit does come upon them in the form of fire. And so there's wind, there's noises, there's fire, there's people speaking in tongues. There's a lot of commotion happening in Acts chapter 2. And then Peter, who's one of the disciples of Jesus, he takes this opportunity to stand up and he delivers the sermon whereby he's describing who Jesus is and how Jesus was a fulfillment of the Old Testament and how he is the true Messiah that has been promised for years and years. And from this sermon, 3,000 people get baptized. They believe in what Peter said. They believe in Jesus and they get baptized and start following Jesus. They become followers of Christ. But now there's a problem. The rest of the Jews, the Jewish authorities, the Jewish community are not happy with this. They're not happy that this new movement, this new faith of Christians are growing in numbers. So what they do is they start looking for ways to persecute these people. And so in Acts 7, they single out this man called Stephen. If you remember, he was one of the seven chosen deacons alongside Philip. So they single him out and then they question him. And upon questioning him, they stone him to death. They kill Stephen. When this happened, there's widespread persecution of all the disciples. If you are a follower of Christ at this moment, you're living life on the edge. You will be hunted down. These disciples of Jesus were being thrown into prison. They were being thrown into cages with lions. They were being beaten and they were being killed. And what happened was they scattered. They ran away looking for refuge. Some went to Judea, some Samaria, and some to the ends of the earth. And when they got to where they went, they started talking to the people, talking to the locals about Jesus. And the locals, the people, believed in Jesus, and they got baptized. And so what Jesus said in Acts 1 verse 8 came to fruition. They became witnesses, his witnesses, in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and the ends of the earth. So that's just the story of the early church where Philip was a part of. And Philip goes to this place called Samaria. Now, I'm not going to get into the detail of Samaria, but if there's one thing you need to know about the people living in Samaria is that they did not get along with Jewish people. There's tension between them. There's hatred between them. And so the Holy Spirit says to instructs Philip to leave Samaria and to go back up to Jerusalem. And on his way, he meets this chariot. He sees this chariot, and the Spirit says to Philip, go over to this chariot and join it, to which Philip does. And when he gets there, he sees this Ethiopian man reading the scroll, and then he asks him a simple question. He asks him, do you understand what you are reading? This is a very important question, because when Philip gets to the man, he doesn't ask him, where are you from? What culture do you believe in? Or tell me, why is your skin that color? He doesn't ask him any of those questions. All he asks him is, do you understand what you are reading? This is a very important question, because he overlooked the man's color, where he was from. He just got to the bottom of the matter, which was understanding what's in front of you. To which the man replies, how can I unless someone guides me? This man was reading something he did not understand. Yes, he believed in God. He's been searching for God, but he doesn't quite understand this God person, right? And so he's reading the scroll in Isaiah, which we will look at in a second. And then he asked Philip, about whom does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? This man, he really wants to know, And so Philip takes this opportunity to talk to this man about Jesus. He doesn't try to unpack the Hebrew scripture and try and tell him a lot of things. All he does is talk to him about Jesus. And so the two of them jump into the chariot and they ride along. And I love this picture because it was a picture of two men who come from different countries, who look differently, who both have different social statuses, and yet here they are together talking about Jesus. Now that is the power of the gospel. Now I want to look at the story from the perspective of this Ethiopian man, this Ethiopian eunuch. See, from the second point, you'll see that the Ethiopian had found in Jesus what he had not found in Jerusalem. All his life had been a preparation for this moment. His education enabled him to read. His scholarship enabled him to read the language of the Bible, which is Hebrew. The scrolls were written in Hebrew. His high position made it possible for him to travel to Jerusalem. His wealth made it possible for him to buy an Isaiah scroll. The disappointment in being excluded from the temple brought a hunger to his heart. And so this just, in this box here, just shows what it meant to be a eunuch and how you would look and things like that. But I just want to go back to what it says before that, point five. His disappointment in being excluded from the temple brought a hunger to his heart. See, this man traveled from Ethiopia to Jerusalem, and he was looking for God. But despite all that, despite his position, he would still have not been allowed in the temple to worship God simply because of one commandment, one rule in the book of Deuteronomy. This is what Deuteronomy says: no one who has been emasculated by crushing or cutting may enter the assembly of the Lord. In other words, if you are a eunuch, you're not allowed to enter the temple of the Lord to worship God. Imagine how he must have felt excluded. Again, come back to the whole concept of exclusion. It's something that we are used to. And this man, he was excluded from worshiping. He must have been in an outer space somewhere close to the temple, but he was not allowed in the temple. Isn't it funny how people can use the words of God to rule you, to dictate your life? This man was being told by the word of God he could not worship. And so he's reading the scroll of Isaiah. He's reading this passage: like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before a shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. This man is reading this, and he's wondering, who was this talking about? And so Philip tells him how this is talking about Jesus. You might be wondering, how is this talking about Jesus? Well, let me break it down for you. See, Jesus was silent before his shearers. Jesus was abused by the Sanhedrin. Jesus was ridiculed by King Herod. Jesus was scourged by Pilate. He was mocked by the Roman soldiers. All his dignity was stripped away, and yet he always remained silent. As the eunuch reads the text, he wonders, why would this man's own people deprive him of justice, the posterity of children, and ultimately his life? But then he's not wanting this for nothing, because to him it's like, I can relate to this guy. That's why he asks Philip, about whom does the prophet say this, about himself or about someone else? Basically, he's asking Philip, tell me, who is this guy? Who is this guy that the prophet is talking about? Because I know what he's going through. I know what he's feeling. Because the same thing that's happening to him has happened to me. So please tell me, who is the prophet talking about? Is it himself or is it someone else? See, if you live life as if there's no hope, there's nothing waiting for you at the end of the road, as if there's no hope for a better tomorrow. You are going to live your life a certain way. And so this was how this Ethiopian man lived his life, as if, hey, I'm being excluded from worshiping this God I've heard about and this God I believe in, so it is what it is. But I'm sure that Philip changed his view, changed his mindset, because they were reading Isaiah 53. Three chapters later, which is Isaiah 56, I'm sure they must have gotten to this part of the scripture. This is what Isaiah 56 says. Do not let the eunuch say, look, I am a dry tree. For this is what the Lord says to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths and choose what pleases me and hold firmly to my covenant. To them I will give in my house and within my walls a memorial and a name better than that of sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name which will not be cut off. Can you imagine the joy in the Ethiopian man's heart as he read through these words, as he read through this promise from God that there is hope of a better tomorrow, simply if you believe and follow his commandments? And what does he do? He gets baptized. He wants to be a part of this family, because remember, if you want to be a part of God's family, you have to be baptized. If you want to be a part of this global family that's so diverse, you have to be baptized, you see. That's why when he sees water, he says, look, here's water. What is to prevent me from being baptized? As I read these words from the Ethiopian man, it's as if I interpret these words as, what is to prevent even me, a black man, a eunuch, who's from far away from being baptized? And Philip, well, I love Philip, because what he does is he stops the chariot and they immediately jump out and they get baptized, because he can see that this man believes in Jesus. He doesn't tell him, you know what, if you want to be a part of this family, you've got to do A, B, C, and D. He doesn't say any of that, because this man believes in Jesus. That's the most critical thing about being a part of God's family. You've got to believe that his son Jesus is the true Messiah, the true King that we're waiting for. And so they get baptized, and the Spirit takes Philip away from the man. Now, I'll go back to the slide. Some of you might be thinking about the third point in the slide. What if I'm not African? Does this still apply to me? Like, what if I'm European? What if I'm American? What if I'm Asian? Does this still apply to me? Well, now I'm about to show you how this also applies to you, regardless of what you are or where you're from. See, the word Ethiopia, if you just Google its meaning, it means any member of any of the mythical or actual people, usually described by the ancient Greeks as dark-skinned and living far to the south. Far to the south referred to Africa, because Africa was far from where Greek was in all of these countries. Or it means a black person. So back in those days, if you were a black person, they would refer to you as an Ethiopian man or woman. You were Ethiopian, simply because you're from far south, where the sun is, where the equator is, so you are dark-skinned, you are darkened by the sun, hence you are Ethiopian. That's what Ethiopian means. And actually, Ethiopia back in the day was not Ethiopia, the country we know today. It was actually the south of Egypt and the north of Sudan. That was Ethiopia back then. Now, having said that, I want us to go to this book, Song of Solomon, because it's a book where King Solomon writes about his love life, this love life between him and this woman. But it's more than that. It's actually a metaphor for Jesus Christ and his bride. Jesus Christ and his bride. And if there's anything you need to know, is that we are the bride of Christ. We, as the church, we are the bride of Christ. If you are baptized into the saving name of Jesus and you become part of the church and so become the bride of Christ. And this is what it says in the very first chapter of this book. This is the young woman who is the bride speaking. How right they are to adore you. She's speaking to Jesus, the groom. And she says in from verse 5, I am dark, but beautiful. O woman of Jerusalem, dark as the tents of Kedar, dark as the curtains of Solomon's tents. Don't stare at me because I am dark. The sun has darkened my skin. Wow. The bride of Christ is dark-skinned. The bride of Christ has been darkened by the sun. Wow. And isn't that a beautiful metaphor for the reality of the world we live in? That here we are, we're waiting for our groom as the church of Christ, as the bride of Christ. We're waiting for our groom, Jesus, to come back. For he is the light of the world, and he will brighten this whole wide world. So this is us as a family. Doesn't matter if you're European, doesn't matter if you are Asian, American, doesn't matter if you are African. We are all Ethiopians. We are all part of the church, the bride of Christ. And we are waiting for our groom to return. And so this story applies to all of us as the bride of Christ, as the church. And I would like to end it with this picture of this Ethiopian man with a smile on his face because he's being baptized. He's joining the family of Christ. And this is my message to you. If you haven't been baptized as yet, don't you want to be a part of God's family? Don't you want to be a part of the bride, the church? If your answer is yes, then my question to you is, what's stopping you from being baptized? Thank you for listening.